Hey everyone, myself Neha Gupta, your mentor for current affairs. So I'm back after a little long break. So first let me inform you why I was on the break. I hope all of you are already aware of it, but let me inform you that because my throat was sore because of this changing of weather as well as the air pollution in Delhi, that's why I was sick and I was not able to take your lectures. So please guys, all my students, take care of your health, your throat, your nose and everything in this pollution, in this changing weather, because this is the weather which can make you feel under the weather. Okay, so let's begin today's class. This class is going to be a little longer because we have to cover the current affairs from November 1st to 21st. It was such a long break that you must have lost track of the current affairs. Therefore, I have brought to you the questions from all the 21 days of the November month. Okay, so that is the first information. The second information is that I will keep my pace a little faster because we have to complete all the questions in a given time frame. I don't want this session to stretch beyond 1 to 1.5 hours because you also don't have time. It's the morning time and I know you all are running short of time. Maybe you all have offices or anything else. So I will try to keep the pace a little faster. So if you are not able to understand anything, you are welcome to provide your doubts in the comment section below. Okay, I will resolve them in the comment section. And if it is possible, if your doubt is not resolved in the comment section, I will take that doubt up in the next class. On that note, let me inform you that from today onwards, the classes are resuming. Okay, so let's begin. This is our mobile application. I hope all of you are aware. Daily GK is updated here. Even if I was not able to take the videos, I have provided the daily GK on the application. So I hope you were in touch with the current affairs. Okay, so the very first question that we have is, recently, Indian Institute of Geomagnetism and Autonomous Research Institution under DST has developed the first indigenous overhousing magnetometer of India at the Alibag Magnetic Observatory. Where is the institute located? So this institute, guys, is located in Mumbai. Okay, this Indian Institute of Geomagnetism is located in Mumbai and this Alibag Observatory is also there in Maharashtra. So this entire thing is happening in Maharashtra only. I hope you are recalling what I am telling you because these first 10 questions are from the November 1st video itself. Okay, so I hope this video will help you in recalling the facts of the first video of this month. So there is nothing much in this video. It's just that an observatory magnetometer has been installed at an observatory and it is India's first indigenous overhouser magnetometer. So this much is enough that you need to remember. Moving on to the second question. Union Ministry of Forest and Environment has given its approval to the Terai Elephant Reserve, which covers 3049 square kilometer, including Dudhwa Tiger Reserve and Pilbhit Tiger Reserve, located in Lakhimpur and Pilbhit districts. The reserve is being developed under the Project Elephant. When was the project launched? So guys, this Project Elephant was launched in 1992. Project Tiger was launched in 1975. And Project Cheetah, under which the 8 cheetahs were brought into India, is there in 2022. Basically, this relocation is termed as Project Cheetah. Okay? So remember these important wildlife projects. Now as far as this entire news is concerned, so you just need to know that this Terai Elephant Reserve is in Uttar Pradesh and it is going to subsume the Dudhwa Tiger Reserve and Pilbhit Tiger Reserve. And it is going to be the first of its kind reserve which will have 4 very precious mammals. First is tiger, fun horn, rhinoceros, Asian elephant and swamp deer. So it is the reserve conservation place for all these precious wild animals. Now it will be the second elephant reserve in Uttar Pradesh and the 33rd elephant reserve of India. Okay. Okay, so here we have certain extra facts, that is the knowledge nugget. First is the launch year of Project Elephant. Second is the date of Elephant Day, that is August 12. And third information is that India has the largest and most stable population of the Asian elephants. More than 60% of all the wild Asian elephants reside in India. So that is another fact that you should be aware of. One more fact is that monitoring the illicit killing of elephants program, which is acronymed as MIKE program, was launched in 2003 to examine the trends and information about the illegal killings of elephants. So this is the program that was launched under the sites and the basic idea is to prevent the killing of elephants. Okay, this was a question in your RBI examination. That's why it is important for you to remember that such kinds of projects are asked. Now, sites is your convention on international trade in endangered species of wild fauna and flora. So this is the full form of CITES, and the implementation year, or you can say the ratification year of CITES, is your question. You are going to tell me in the comment section below. Okay, so the third question is that the Meghalaya government has launched the Meghalaya Credit Guarantee Scheme. Okay, I hope you are recalling what I have taught you in the first video. The question is telling you that the Meghalaya government has signed an MOU with the Credit Guarantee Fund Trust for micro and small enterprises for implementing its Meghalaya Credit Guarantee Scheme. This MOU will strengthen the credit delivery system and facilitate the flow of credit to the MSMEs. Obviously, the total corpus of the Meghalaya Credit Guarantee Scheme is 250 crores. Considering the average loan size of 1 lakh, more than 25,000 units are going to get benefit from this scheme. What is the percentage of risk coverage given by this scheme? So here guys, the percentage is 95%. Okay, so let's discuss this news. Meghalaya government has signed this MOU with the Credit Guarantee Fund Trust for micro and small enterprises, which is an initiative of the Ministry of MSME. Do remember this fact. Okay, now this is a credit guarantee scheme. So basically, the Meghalaya government is going to give the guarantee to the banks on the behalf of the MSME borrower. Okay, what kind of guarantee? The guarantee is that if the borrower is unable to pay you back, then the government is going to step in and provide you the money. Now, how much money will be covered? So money would be 95% of the total loan amount. Okay, I hope you guys are understanding. Now, there is this Credit Guarantee Fund Trust for micro and small enterprises, which provides the guarantee of up to 75%. And because of this 20% gap, the banks were reluctant to give the loans to the MSMEs. Therefore, the Meghalaya government has launched this scheme. Otherwise, there was no need for such a scheme. This scheme has been specifically launched to increase the risk coverage. Okay. We have read the total corpus of this scheme is going to be 250 crores. Okay. So do remember the total corpus of this scheme. Okay, question number 4 is, which edition of the Singapore-India Maritime Bilateral Exercise is conducted in 2022? So guys, it was the 29th edition. Okay, many times editions are asked of the defense exercise. It is Singapore-India Maritime Bilateral Exercise, which was held in October in Vishakhapatnam. So do remember. Sindex exercise began in 1994 as exercise Lion King. Okay, so this is another fact related to Simbex, which is important for you to remember. Now, as we have the knowledge nuggets, so why not increase the knowledge with these extra informations? So the very first information is that India and Singapore also conduct the Bold Kurukshetra Army exercise. There is no Air Force exercise between India and Singapore. And the trilateral exercise in which India and Singapore both participate is SITMEX. So here Singapore, India and Thailand, both, all the three countries participate. Okay. Singapore's capital is Singapore City only, and the currency is dollar. So here guys, Singapore is a member of Asia Nations. So here you can clearly see the map of the Asia Nations. And if you want to remember these Asia Nations, then you can divide these nations into two categories of 5 nations each. Okay, let me show you how. So here, this could be your one group and this is your another group. Okay, so in this one group, we have Myanmar, Thailand, Laos, Cambodia, Vietnam. Okay. Myanmar, Thailand, Laos, Cambodia, Vietnam. And in the second group, we have Malaysia, Singapore, Indonesia, Brunei and Philippines. Okay, Malaysia, Singapore, Indonesia, Brunei and Philippines. So these are the two groups of the Asia nations through which you can remember. Now, as far as the flags are concerned, so have a look at the flags also, because sometimes the flags are asked, although majority of the time such questions are asked in either your SSC type of examination or your UPSC type of examination. Like a question can be made like, on which country's flag you have a red and white combination along with the moon and the stars. So here the right answer would be Singapore. Okay. Okay. So we are on the question number 5. Where has the Prime Minister Narendra Modi laid foundation stone of a C-295 aircraft manufacturing facility? So here the right answer is option D, Vadodara. Earlier this facility was to be developed in Maharashtra, but now it has been shifted to Gujarat, Vadodara. Okay? So it is a very basic news. A manufacturing facility is going to be set up. Who is going to set up this facility? It is a consortium led by Tata Advanced Systems Limited and Airbus Defence and Space Company, which is a European company. Okay. Now remember that the manufacturing of C-295 aircraft takes place in Spain. Okay, this Airbus company is a pan-European company. So it is spread across various nations, and specifically this C-295 facility is located in Spain only. So the global production takes place in Spain. Now there are many firsts attached to this C-295 facility. The first is that it is the first project of its kind wherein a military aircraft will be manufactured by a private company, Tata Advanced Systems Limited. So the technology transfer is going to take place between Airbus and Tata. It is also the first time that the C-295 aircraft will be manufactured outside Europe. Okay, so that is also you can say a thing of proud for us, because the first place which Airbus has chosen for the manufacturing of its C-295 aircraft is India. So this is the aircraft which we were talking about. Question number 6. Who heads IRDAI's new panel for expanding affordable and comprehensive cover for the rural population? So here Thomas M. Devasia is the right answer. A committee has been formed which is going to inform the IRDAI about the coverage in the rural areas, as well as recommend ways to increase the coverage of insurance in the rural areas. Now this product will be called as the Bima Vistar, the product which this committee will recommend. Okay, because here what we are going to do, we are spreading the reach of the Bima. Bima is insurance, Vistar is the spread. Okay, so Bima Vistar is going to be the name of this product. So this committee is also going to recommend IRDAI the ways in which the entire distribution channel of insurance would be led by them. Okay, now what do we mean by distribution channel? The distribution channel means the selling or the increasing the coverage of insurance, as well as increasing the awareness about insurance. So why not employ women for that work, for informing the people about insurance and its needs and everything about insurance, and as at the same time employing women for enrolling the people into insurance schemes. So that would be the women centric distribution channel, and the roadmap for that also will be recommended by this committee. Okay, so the distribution channel will be called as Bima Vah. Now guys, what kind of questions can be made out of such statements? First question would be, which of the following statement is correct about Bima Vah? So you should be aware of Bima Vah content or the basic idea behind this Bima Vah product. Okay, the committee will also explore how to bring synergies in the work operations of Bima Vah, Bima Vista and the Bima Sugam portal which IRDAI has recently launched. Okay. Okay, so the question number 7 is, who heads IRDAI's health insurance consultative committee? So here, what is the right answer? The right answer is option A. Rakesh Joshi heads this health insurance consultative committee, and this 15 member committee is also going to give a roadmap for the universal health insurance coverage. Okay. Now here we have certain extra informations about the authority, IRDAI. So guys, IRDAI is a statutory body. I hope all of you are aware of this, that we have a specific act, the Insurance Regulatory and Development Authority of India Act, through which this authority came into existence. However, this authority is under the administration, or you can say administrative control, of the Ministry of Finance. So that is an interesting fact, so remember that. Okay, so this IRDAI Act came in 1999, and the headquarters of IRDAI is in Hyderabad, so do remember. And one more act is there related to insurance, that is the Insurance Act of 1938. However, we don't need to remember anything about the Insurance Act. Okay, this act basically governs the insurance business in India. Then the current chair of IRDAI is Debashish Panda. Okay, so current chairs are always important. Question number 8. Recently, the Gujarat government has become the 7th state to achieve the 100% tap water connections in rural areas under the Jal Jeevan Mission. The vision of the scheme is that every rural household has a drinking water supply in adequate quantity of prescribed quality on a regular and long-term basis at affordable service delivery charges, leading to improvement in the living standards of the rural communities. What is the quantity of water supply prescribed by the scheme per person per day? So here guys, again, a person who has read thoroughly would be able to answer this question. The answer is 55 liters per day. So the scheme aims to provide 55 liters per day per person to every rural household by 2024. Now Gujarat at this moment has become the 7th state in India to achieve the 100% rural tap water connections. Let's know more about it. So this PAD was achieved on the Gujarati New Year, which comes immediately after the Diwali. Okay, and this Jal Jeevan Mission was launched in 2019. The purpose of it is to provide this much water per person to every rural household by 2024. All the highlighted portions are important. So this only tells you about what we have just discussed, so you can read it on your own. Now one more thing here is that Goa, Telangana, Andaman Nicobar, Dadra and Nagar Haveli and Daman and Diu, Puducherry, Haryana and Gujarat, these are the top 7 states or the only 7 states and UTs which have achieved the 100% tap water connections. Okay, so the 9th question is, S.S. Rajamouli's period epic RRR has won the Best International Filmfare Award, Film Award at Dash. So it is that Saturn Awards. Best Film Award at the Saturn Awards has been given to the Tom Cruise's Top Gun Maverick. Maverick is the name of the movie. Top Gun Maverick. Okay. Question number 10 is, recently Swastik Sai Raj Ranki Reddy and Chirag Shetty won the men's doubles title at the French Open Super 750 badminton tournament. The men's single was won by the Victor Axelsen, who won the women's single. So women's single has been won by He Bingjiao from China. Question number 11. ISRO's RESET 2 satellite re-entered the Earth's atmosphere in Indian Ocean near Jakarta on October 30. When was the satellite launched? So this satellite was launched in 2009. So as you guys can see, my throat is still not well. So please take care of yourself, guys, because once you fall ill, it is going to take time to recover. And the pollution is such that you cannot escape this. So this is going to happen. Give me just 2 seconds. Okay, so let's begin. The news is about the RESET 2 satellite, which is the communication satellite launched in 2009, and it made an uncontrolled re-entry into the Earth's atmosphere. That is why it was in the news. When it was launched on the PSLV C-12 launch 1. Okay, what is the currency of Taiwan? So it is dollar. Now, recently, 2022, India-Taiwan Industrial Collaboration Summit has taken place, and it was organized by Taiwan's Chinese National Federation of Industries and India's FICCI. Okay. The extra information here is about Taiwan, because we are studying that Taiwan and India have conducted a summit. So why not discuss about Taiwan? First information is that Taiwan or the Republic of China, I hope you know about this name differentiation. Taiwan calls itself as Republic of China, whereas the China calls itself People's Republic of China. So that's the distinction. Now we are going to talk about this as well. But first have a look at the capital. It's the Taipei city and dollar is the currency. Now this one China policy is the stand. It's a political condition or situation wherein the People's Republic of China claims Taiwan as a part of the mainland China. Okay, so that is the one China policy and it is not related to the one child policy of China. Okay. Okay, Taiwan's main exports are electronic products, metal products, plastics, rubber, chemical and machinery. Taiwan holds 60% market share in the silicon, okay, in the semiconductor chip market. So this is a very huge percentage and that is why US is very much inclined to protect Taiwan from the intrusion of China. So that's the basic reason, because if China intrudes Taiwan, so China would be literally controlling the international market. It is also doing that through its exports, but still, if 60% of semiconductor market goes to China, then it would be a really really very tricky situation for the world trade. Taiwan Semiconductor Manufacturing Company, TSMC, is the biggest semiconductor company and it alone holds approximately, or you can say more than 50% of the stake of the world market. The next question is, who heads the high level panel of Ministry of Education to strengthen the assessment and accreditation of high educational institutions? So here guys, what is the right answer of this question? The right answer is K. Radhakrishnan. So Ministry of Education has basically created a new committee which will provide the roadmap for the assessment and accreditation of the higher educations. Okay, how will these higher education perform so that the accreditation, the formal recognition should be given to these institutions? So the chairperson of this committee would be K. Radhakrishnan, who is the chairperson of the board of governors of IIT Kanpur. Okay, so K. Radhakrishnan and Kanpur, this much is enough. You need to remember this much. Okay, K. Radhakrishnan belongs to IIT Kanpur, that is enough, and he is the chairperson of this panel. Okay, so the tasks of this committee would be to strengthen the assessment and accreditation program for the National Accreditation Council as per the National Education Policy of 2020. Now, K. Kasturi Ranjan Committee was the committee which drafted the education policy. Do remember that. Okay, so question number 14 is, Ministry of Home Affairs has completed the Mother Tongue Survey of India with field videography of the country's 576 languages. The NIC and the National Film Development Corporation will be documenting and preserving the linguistic data of the surveyed mother tongues in audio-video files. According to the 2011 Linguistic Survey, Hindi is the most widely spoken mother tongue, with 52.8 crore people or 43.6% of the population declaring it as the mother tongue. Which language is the second most popular mother tongue in India? So here, guys, Bengali is the right answer. So here, right now, the Ministry of Home Affairs has conducted the Mother Tongue Survey of India. Okay, 576 languages have been documented through this exercise, and the web archive of this exercise is kept at the National Informatics Center. National Informatics Center is the government's IT company which provides different kinds of websites and portals for the government. Now, the NIC and NFDC have documented the linguistic data, and we have one very important document or data, that is the 2011 Linguistics Census. Okay, according to this census, Hindi is the most widely spoken mother tongue, and after Hindi, Bengali is the most widely spoken mother tongue. Okay, as per the 2011 survey, more than 19,500 languages or dialects are spoken as mother tongues in India. So this is such a vibrant number, more than 19,500 languages, or you can say including the dialects, it is increased to 19,500, but still it's a very huge number. So we should respect and try to preserve the languages of India, and many languages in India, for example, because Sanskrit is also on the verge of dying because nobody as of now is learning Sanskrit. So we should lay an emphasis on preserving and conserving the languages. What do you think on that? If you have any suggestions, how can we preserve our linguistic heritage, you can provide that in the comment section below. Okay, coming back to the question number 15, which states that in November 2022, Supreme Court upheld the validity of the Employees Pension Amendment Scheme of 2014, but quashed the threshold limit of 15,000 monthly salary for joining the pension fund. What was the income limit prior to 2014 notification? So here, guys, 6,500 rupees is the right answer. So that is the basic news, that Supreme Court has withheld the validity of this amendment, and this amendment had raised the monthly income limit for entering into the pension scheme to 15,000. But now the limit to enter the pension fund scheme is 6,500 again. Okay. Next question is, which city will host the 17th Pravasi Bharatiya Divas Convention? So guys, it is India's cleanest city which is going to host it. Now, I hope you have understood the answer. It is Indore. So guys, Pravasi Bharatiya Divas Convention. So Pravasi Bharatiya Divas is celebrated on January 9th. And the basic idea of this Divas is to commemorate the coming back of Mahatma Gandhi, and the convention is celebrated to acknowledge the contributions of the NRIs. Okay, so that is the basic idea. I think there is nothing much to discuss here. Let's jump to the second question, 17th question. Which has become the second city in India to issue municipal bonds to fund infrastructure projects? So here, Vadodara again is there in the news. It is the right answer. So we have two important news related to Vadodara. First is your C295 facility, and second is the municipal bonds. Okay, remember two important news in Vadodara: C295 manufacturing facility and municipal bonds. Okay, now let's discuss about this news. Municipal bonds. First of all, remember Vadodara is the second city. So which one is the first city? It is Pune. Pune became the first city to issue the municipal bonds in 2017 only. Now, what are the municipal bonds? Every kind of bond is issued to raise money. So these municipal bonds are issued by the municipal corporations, which in turn are the government organizations. So they issue the bonds to raise money, and that money is used to develop the infrastructure. So that is the basic idea of the municipal bonds. Okay. Now, related to municipal or corporations and the bonds, I remember that RBI has recently released its report on the finances of municipal corporations. And Gulab Sa Ma'am has covered this report thoroughly a few days back only. So I hope all of you have covered that video, this report from that video. Please cover this report from there in detail for your phase 2 finance current affairs point of view. Okay. As far as the phase 1 is concerned, so wait for a second. I am going to tell you the report only. Okay. Finances of municipal corporation. Okay. So what's the crux of this report? This report tells about the sources of finances of the municipal corporations, and it also states that there is an urgent need of bringing transparency in the entire process of financing as well as the managing of the fundings of these municipal corporations. There is one more fact that the capital expenditure of these municipal corporations is less and the operational cost is higher. Okay, so the majority funding is going into the operation cost. So such kinds of very conceptual things were given in this report, which is not at all important for the phase one current affairs because they ask you the facts. So there is no fact in this report, so you don't have to mud up facts or the concepts from this report for phase one at least. Okay, for phase two, again I would say watch Gulab Sa Ma'am's video. A few days back only that video came out. Okay, question number 18. Which state is hosting the first edition of the Doku Emong Bird Count Festival between November 4 to 7, a 4-day event to document the birds in the state? So here guys, what is the right answer? It is Nagaland. Let me tell you that Nagaland is the only home for the Emud falcon in the world. Okay, so these falcons travel from Arctic to Nagaland, and this is the only home for these travelers. Okay, Emud falcons. Now coming back to this news, it's just an event. Remember the name of the event, Doku Emong. Okay, because that's a very, you can say, a differently sounding name of the festival. Apart from this, there is nothing much. It's the first avian documentation exercise undertaken by the Nagaland government. Not the government. The event is organized by the government, but the bird watchers are going to count the birds and their species. Question number 19. Recently, a new species of endemic honeybee named Apis carinjordiana, Indian black honeybee, it is also known as Indian black honeybee, it has been discovered in the Western Ghats after a gap of more than 200 years. When was the National Beekeeping and Honey Mission launched? So here the entire question has been flipped. So you have to pay attention to the question itself. The first statement is telling you about the recent discovery. So your mindset would be about the recent discovery only. In the examination hall, you might recall all the facts that you must have read about this black honeybee. But what the question is asking you? The question is asking you about the National Beekeeping and Honey Mission. So please read the question carefully. Now coming back to the news. So this mission was launched in 2020. So the news is very simple. Indian black honeybee has been found again after 200 years in the Western Ghats. Now the total species of honeybees in the world, remember, in the world, has increased to 11. So this is a very important fact for you to remember. Guys, apiculture is the name of the practice of rearing honeybees for economic purposes. So do remember the word apiculture, because sometimes general questions are made. Apiculture is related to which of the following agricultural practices? Okay, so you can expect such a question in your SEBI general awareness as well as RBI. Okay, don't restrict or narrow down it to just NABARD examination. This is a very basic question. Okay, now let's have a look at the global apiculture market. So this market had a CAGR of 4.3% during 2020 to 2025. Okay, so this is the expected CAGR, the compound annual growth rate. So on an average, this apiculture market is going to grow at 4.3% rate every year between 2020 to 2025. That is what it means. The Indian apiculture market size is expected to reach this much amount, 33,128 million by 2024, at a CAGR of 12% by 2024. Again, it's a forecast statement, so it is important. India is the sixth major natural honey bee, sorry, honey exporting country. Again, very important. So these are the facts, guys, that you need to remember for your examination. Okay, if you have any examination coming near, then this is very, very important. And if you have RBSFA NABARD as target, because these examinations are going to come next year, so what you can do is you can just have a reading of these facts again and again, and you can also make notebook of your own, or you can highlight in the PDF itself the facts that I tell you, and when the examination comes near, I would try to remember these facts again and again. Okay, so that would be your memorization technique. Now, the National Beekeeping and Honey Mission was launched in 2020, and it was launched under the Ministry of Agriculture and Farmer Welfare. Very basic question, in order to give a boost to the sweet revolution. So sweet revolution is related to what? Honey. National Beekeeping and Honey Mission aimed to establish 5 big regional and 100 small honey and other bee product testing laboratories. This is a very important target of this mission, and testing laboratories are very, very important as far as the honey product is concerned, because honey is known by its quality, and quality is always tested. Okay, so do remember its target. The next question is, where was the 15th edition of the AgroTech India organized by the Confederation of Indian Industry? So it was organized in Chandigarh. The theme of this AgroTech India Summit was digital transformation for sustainable agriculture and food security. So here three things are important: edition, place and theme. So these three things are important from this news, you can remember. Question number 21. So this is going to take a little more time than other questions, because this is about COP27 of UNFCCC, which was held in Egypt. Okay, so whenever this COP is conducted, we have a lot to cover. So we are going to cover all of that in this question. First of all, the question is asking, India has joined the Mangrove Alliance for Climate during COP27 of UNFCCC at Sharm el-Sheikh in Egypt. Which of the following countries is not a part of the alliance? So here, guys, Australia, Sri Lanka, Japan, United Kingdom and Spain. The most likely option would be Sri Lanka, right? It is appearing the most likely option. But guys, if you are thinking Sri Lanka, then you are wrong. The right answer is United Kingdom. So never judge a book by its cover. That's the lesson here. So UK, guys, is not a part of this Mangrove Alliance for Climate. So India has joined this Mangrove Alliance for Climate during the COP27 of UNFCCC, which was held at this location. The members of this alliance are Australia, Japan, Spain and Sri Lanka and India. What's the purpose? This alliance will help India in achieving the nationally determined contributions. What are the NDCs? NDCs are a part of the climate Paris Agreement of 2015. Okay, so under this NDC was, you can say, the nationally determined contributions were made by every signatory. Okay, so India has also determined certain targets in order to reduce the emissions and achieve the climate resilience. Okay, so this alliance is going to help India in achieving its targets under the Paris Agreement. How? By reducing the carbon dioxide emissions. Okay, so it is going to create an additional carbon sink of 2.5 to 3 billion tons of carbon dioxide equivalent through additional forest and tree cover by 2030. Okay, so mangroves are the carbon sink, so they are going to absorb the carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, and this in turn will help India in achieving the NDC. The next point is that according to the State of the World's Mangroves Report 2022, human-driven loss represents 62% of total losses of over 600 square kilometers of the mangroves for 2010 to 2020. So what this statement is saying, that the entire loss of the mangroves, out of that, 62% is driven by the human activities, the anthropogenic activities. Okay, so humans are that dangerous for the planet. India accounts for over 50% of the total mangrove cover in the South Asian region. Okay, as per the Forest Survey of 2021, the top three states showing an increase in the mangrove cover are Odisha, Maharashtra and Karnataka. Okay, so mangroves are spread across different states in India. It's not only restricted to the West Bengal area. Okay, next initiative that was signed, or that was in limelight during the COP27, was the International Drought Resilience Alliance. Now, what does this alliance say? Spain and Senegal led 30 countries and 20 organizations in this Drought Resilience Alliance. Now, the very basic idea of it is to provide support so that the countries can become resilient in the face of droughts and they can withstand this situation and prevent such situation from happening again. Okay. So, in this alliance, the countries are going to help each other for preparing against the future droughts. The IDRA was first announced by Spain at the 77th edition of the UN General Assembly in September 2022, and it has been launched at the COP27. According to the Drought and Numbers report compiled by the United Nations Convention to Combat Desertification, droughts have increased in frequency by 29% since 2000, with around 55 million people affected every year. Okay, drought generated economic losses from 1998 to 2017 were about $125 billion across the world, not to mention the cost of the human suffering and lives. Now, we have read both the statements. What's the utility of reading the statements? First thing, forget this statement. Okay, this is not going to help you out anywhere in your phase one as well as descriptive portion. What this statement is saying, that the economic losses amount to $124 billion in this tenure. Okay, not a very significant statement from exam perspective. However, this droughts in numbers report, according to this report, the droughts have increased by 29% and they affect 55 million people. So here two facts are there, 27% and 55 million people are affected by droughts. So these two facts are important only. So what you can do is, in your PDF, which you will get of Spotlight and Daily GK PDF, I have already provided, you can just write it down. If you have taken out a printout, 29%. 55 million people. Okay, so that the next time when you see at the PDF, you are just looking at these facts and try to remember the facts. Okay, so you don't have to mug up this much information. This information is provided so that you know about it. Okay, ek awareness bhi bahut zaruri hai bahut sari cheezon ko lekar, but zaruri nahi hai ki har cheez ko yaad kiya jaye, otherwise you won't be able to crack the examination. The third initiative is the action plan of the World Meteorological Organization, which is not very very important. It's just that इसको भी कुछ करना था COP27 में, तो इसने एक plan of action launch कर दिया. Otherwise इसको limelight नहीं मिलती. So इसने क्या किया है? So it has developed this action plan under which it is going to develop a global early warning system for extreme weather. Okay, and the initial investment for this system would be 3.1 billion by 2027. So that is the fact. In my opinion, if you don't remember this fact, that would be enough. Just remember that the global early warning system is going to be developed by the World Meteorological Organization, and it was announced at COP27. Okay, so we have the International Resilience Accelerator Fund. So it is a fund. What's the purpose? The purpose is to provide funding to the countries who want to develop resilient infrastructure and mitigation infrastructure against the natural hazards. Okay, so that's the basic idea. Now, Coalition for Disaster Resilience Infrastructure. Disaster Resilient Infrastructure has launched this accelerator fund, which is basically a multi-partner trust fund. Okay, so many partners are going to provide funding to this fund. Around $50 million has already been announced for this IRAF for a period of 5 years. And obviously, CDRI is an India-led initiative. Therefore, India is going to have an upper hand here as well. Okay, upper hand kehlo ya phir leading light kehlo. India is going to be the leading light in this fund as well. So it is a multi-donor trust fund established with the support of UNDP and UN Office for Disaster Risk Reduction, and it will be managed by the UN Multi-Partner Trust Fund office, which is in New York. Again, not a very significant information because here a lot of facts are there. So just need to remember, it's a multi-donor trust fund. UNDP, UN Disaster Risk Reduction Office, are important, and we have Multi-Partner Trust Fund of UN, which is located at its headquarters, okay, in New York. The fund will support the global action on developing the disaster resilient infrastructure, and especially the focus will be on the developing country and the small island nations, okay, small island developing states. It is supported by India, UK, Australia and European Union, and this statement is very very important, okay, because directly the question can be made on the countries. So India, UK, Australia and European Union. So methane alert response system, which is short formed as MARS, okay, do remember the full form of MARS. Now, it is a satellite based system that enables government to detect the methane emissions, and it is a very I would say innovative as well as an important initiative, because this is going to be the, first of all, it is going to tackle the problem of methane emissions, and secondly, it is a data-driven approach to tackle the climate problem. So that is very important. And thirdly, it is for the first time that satellite would be used to check out the emissions of a particular gas, that is methane. Okay, so all these facts make this initiative very important. Now, it is set up as part of the UNEP, United Nations Environment Programme's International Methane Emissions Observatory Strategy. And this Mars is going to provide data to the governments as well, so that they can take the emission related action. The sixth important initiative is the release of this State of the Climate in Asia 2021 report. So it is again released by the World Meteorological Organization. So according to this report, in 2021 alone, weather and water related hazards caused total damage of 35.6 billion, affecting 50 million people. Again, this statement is not very important. You just need to remember that this report has been released by the WM, because that can be a direct question. Economic damage from drought has increased by 63% from the flood has increased by 23%, and landslides, the economic loss has increased by 147% as compared to the average of 2001 to 2020. Okay, so again, this is highlighting the economic loss that the world is bearing due to the climate change. The Asian region is bearing due to the climate change. But again, if you can remember such data, try to remember it, because this data is helpful in your descriptive answers. But if there is a lot to take in, then don't try to remember such data, because they are not asked in the phase 1 current affairs. Okay, so don't try to mug them. Then we have India's long-term low emission development strategy. So guys, it is also developed under the Paris Agreement. So it was a condition, or you can say a mandatory requirement under the Paris Agreement, that every signatory will have to develop its low emission development strategy, and now India has developed it. Okay, so it is descriptive in nature, the strategy, therefore we don't have to go into it again. That won't be asked in the examination, not in your phase 1 current, and not in your ESI current as well. Coming to the next initiative, India has also launched in our lifetime initiative. Okay, so this campaign aims to target youth who are from 18 to 23 years of age. So climate related information will be given to the youth so that they can spread it out to others as well. Okay, so this is inspired from the LIFE campaign, which Prime Minister announced at COP26 in Glasgow last year, and now the Prime Minister has launched in our lifetime campaign. Okay, LIFE stands for Lifestyle for Environment. Now, where in India has Prime Minister launched this LIFE campaign? This is your question. Do mention it in the comment section. The next question is, where has DRDO established its sonar testing facility named Hull Model of Submersible Platform for Acoustic Characterization and Evaluation? So here, SPACE is the full form of this facility. It is the name of this facility. So it has been established at Kochi. So this facility will be of Indian Navy, and it will be at the DRDO's Naval Physical and Oceanographic Laboratory in Kochi. Okay. The basic idea of it is to test the sonar equipments of the ships. Okay. Question number 23. Which of the following Indian Navy ships has received the Certificate of Commendation from the International Maritime Organization at the Annual Bravery Awards Ceremony of IMO in London? So here, INS Kochi and Kolkata are the right answer. So option D is the right answer. Now, along with INS Kochi and Kolkata, great ship Ahilya has also won this Certificate of Commendation from the International Maritime Organization. So here, let's know certain facts about the IMO as well. First is, the Director Secretary General of IMO is Peter Lim, and the headquarters is in London. The parent organization is UN, and it was established in 1948 through the Convention on International Maritime Organization in Geneva, okay, which was signed in Geneva. Which PSU has signed the MOU with the Small Industries Development Bank of India for MSMEs to promote energy efficiency financing for MSMEs and explore the Internet of Things based solutions, greening MSMEs, capacity building of various stakeholders? So here guys, option D is the right answer, that is B. So B stands for Bureau of Energy Efficiency. Now, before jumping into the news itself, let me inform you that this B is also responsible for implementing the Gram Ujala scheme. Under which the LED lights are given to the rural households at very cheap price, that is of rupees 10. It is also implementing the street lighting project. Okay, so these are the two flagship schemes which the Bureau of Energy Efficiency is implementing. Okay, so it's a very basic news. We have read about this MOU. Now let's discuss question number 25. Which country has launched Gaia 100 satellite carrying rocket? So here Iran, guys, is the right. So guys, here is the map. So this is, guys, Iran. Okay. And I hope you are aware that Iran was called Persia as well in ancient times. And on the name of Persia, this gulf is named as Persian Gulf. So related to this gulf, we have a very important organization, that is Gulf Cooperation Council. But the very interesting fact here is that the Gulf Cooperation Council does not include Iran. It has Oman, UAE. Let me just zoom it out. Okay. So it has Oman, UAE. Then we have Qatar, Bahrain, and Saudi Arabia, and Kuwait as its members. So the Gulf Cooperation Council has 6 members, do remember. Now, since we are talking about Iran, so I hope all of you are aware that Iran has a very important port, that is Chabahar port here. India is developing that port in Iran because India has an aim. That aim is this international north-south transport corridor. From this port, India plans to develop Chabahar port so that the goods can be transported here, and from here, the goods can be transported to Russia. This blue line is telling you the current standard route which we follow. We have to travel through the Red Sea, through the Mediterranean Sea, and through the North Sea, and then we reach Russia. This Chabahar port is helping out India to reach Russia. However, it is not completed yet. But when it is complete, it will help India to reach Russia and to the South Central Asia through this port. Okay, and let me show you the path to Central Asia. So this is Chabahar port, and through this is the Central Asia. We can enter into the Central Asia, Turkmenistan, Uzbekistan, Kyrgyzstan, Kazakhstan, and Turkmenistan. So these are the 5 countries through which we enter through the Chabahar port, and this is the Russian. Okay. Now there is one more thing. Let's discuss about that briefly. It is India's vision. However, this vision is not converting into reality as of now. But this is the vision. So this is the Mumbai port. India is developing Chabahar port so that India can transport goods to the Central Asia and to Russia through this Chabahar port, because it will definitely reduce the time and cost involved in the trade. And here, through the South Indian and these ports, India plans to develop such trade routes. Okay, so here you can clearly see that through this route, India is planning to enter Myanmar. Through this route, India is planning to again touch Myanmar and your Thailand also. Through this route and through this route, India plans to go to Malaysia. Apart from this, India is also planning to develop a trilateral highway to reach Myanmar and Thailand. Okay, so this is the vision of India. Like China has Belt and Road Initiative, India also has this initiative, or you can say vision, but we don't have that much money to put into this vision. Okay, question number 26 is, which search engine has launched Flood Hub platform to display flood forecast? So here Google is the right answer. Very easy question, nothing much to discuss. So question number 27 is, which country has emerged as the top destination for India's petroleum product exports, such as petrol and diesel, in the first half of the current fiscal year? So here, guys, Netherlands is the right answer. Okay, so what has happened? Let me show you in the graph itself that Netherlands has become the topmost trading partner of India as far as the petroleum products are concerned, and that too is restricted only to the first half of this year. So this data in itself does not hold that much significance. However, I have much more interesting information for you. So let me show you that. So European Union is at present planning to buy diesel grade oil from India. And if European Union does that, then it is going to be a very big bumper opportunity for India, because now we are going to leverage on that part as well. The companies like Reliance, Naira are going to benefit out of it. Okay, so that is the news related to it. However, nothing is fixed as of now. Okay, now this also reminds me that recently Russian companies have opened the Vostro accounts in 2 banks. 9 Vostro accounts have been opened in 2 Indian banks, UCO Bank and IndusInd Bank. So this is a very important information. Now what is a Vostro account? Vostro account is basically your account. Okay, so basically these Vostro accounts have been opened in these banks, but these belong to the Russian companies. Okay, for example, there is SS company of Russia. It has opened a Vostro account in UCO Bank. So the trader, the importer of oil in India, will make the payment in Indian currency in the UCO Bank, and that money will be reserved for this SS company. So that trade will be done in the Indian rupee. Now you would think that what's the benefit to this Russian company if the trade is happening in Indian currency? That too in the Indian bank. The amount is there in the Indian bank. So if we are buying oil from Russia, Russia must buy something from us. Russia would be buying something from us. So that money would be utilized for that. Okay. Suppose this SS has to buy medicines from India. So what will it do? It will now make the payment which is there in the UCO bank already, the money which is there in the UCO bank for buying the medicines from India. So this is how the exchange takes place. Okay. So right now, 9 Vostro accounts have been opened in just 2 banks, UCO and IndusInd. So that's an important information. Question number 28. Central government has constituted the Law Commission of India, and the entire paragraph is telling you about the history of the Law Commission of India. So the question is, that when was the first Law Commission formed? So the first Law Commission was formed in 1955. Recently what has happened, that Rituraj Awasthi has been appointed as a chairperson of the 22nd Law Commission of India. So do remember that 22nd Law Commission has been formed, and Rituraj Awasthi is the chairperson of that commission. Now what is the Law Commission? Why do we form the Law Commission when we have the judiciary separate and the legislature separated, and we have the Ministry of Law and Justice as well? Then why do we create this Law Commission? So guys, a specific commission is created by the government itself so that it can research on the laws, whether the existing laws are apt, whether they need any kind of reformation or not. So that is the functioning of this Law Commission. So let's read some more about the Law Commission. It is a non-statutory body. Okay, it is constituted by the Ministry of Law and Justice with a definite term of reference. Okay, what does this commission have to do? To carry out research in the field of law. And commission makes recommendations to the government in the form of reports as per its terms of reference. These reports are not very important for the examinations. RBI 7 award ke liye to bilkul hi nahi hai, but for UPSC candidates, if any one of you is preparing for UPSC and RBI 7 award simultaneously, so let me inform you that the reports are not very important of these commissions until or unless they have made a very significant recommendation, which is there everywhere in the news. Okay, so that is the thing that you should be aware of before starting preparation from this Law Commission. Central government has established the first Law Commission in 1955, and the chairperson of that was M.C. Setalwar. Okay, every time the first is important. So first commission in 1955, the first chairperson is M.C. Setalwar. Till now 21 Law Commissions have been created, and 22nd is of Rituraj Awasthi. Okay, do remember that Law Commissions have a term of 3 years. So this is the tenure. Do remember this, it's basic. The next question is, which day is observed on the birth anniversary of Madame Curie? So here guys, we celebrate National Cancer Awareness Day. So it is on November 7th, and not only this day, we have other days as well. C.V. Raman's birth anniversary is also celebrated on November 7th. Infant Protection Day is also on November 7th, and the Cancer Awareness Day is also on November 7th. So do remember this. When is the World Day for Prevention of and Healing from Child Sexual Exploitation, Abuse and Violence observed? So it is observed on November 18, and this year it was the first time this day was celebrated. Question number 31st. How many fodder-centric farmer producer organizations will be established by the National Development Dairy Board during 2022 to 2023? A very, very important question, because again, it is related to the government initiative. We have the formation of Farmer Producer Organization scheme, which aims to create 10,000 FPOs in India by 2024 to 2025. That's the very important scheme and the target. And now we have another target, that is 100 fodder-centric FPOs, okay, that will be created by the National Dairy Development Board, which is a part of the Ministry of Fisheries, Animal Husbandry and Dairy. So this is the ministry which is going to create the fodder-centric FPOs. Okay, who is going to use the fodder? Chara kaun charta hai? Animals. Therefore, the basic ministry in charge of this fodder-centric FPO is the Ministry of Animal Husbandry. Do remember. Now, how many FPOs will be created? 100. Okay, the year is 2022 to 2023. Okay, so the country has a fodder deficit of 12 to 15%. 25 to 26%, 36%. Okay, when it comes to green fodder, dry fodder and concentrated fodder respectively. Okay, so 12 to 15% is for green fodder, 25 to 26% is for dry fodder, and 36% is for the concentrated fodder. So this much is the gap deficit, and it's not like that the production is not happening. Maybe it is not reaching to the market as it is in the case of many other agricultural products. Okay, so in order to tap or eliminate that gap, these farmer producer organizations will be created, and 100 will be created within this year. Okay, which has very minimum you can say months left. Okay, we have November, December, January, February and March. 5 months are left. Let's see how many will be created. Question number 32, which country is pioneering the Middle East Green Initiative? So guys, it is the Saudi Arabia which has taken the entire burden of this Middle East Green Initiative on its shoulder. So basically, this initiative is the initiative of Saudi Arabia only. So under this initiative, it is going to plant trees and it is going to make the country green. Okay, it is going to help in reducing carbon emissions from the regional hydrocarbon production by more than 60%. So they are going to increase the hydrocarbon production by more than 60%. Okay, question number 33 is, which is the top ranking institution from India in the QS World University Rankings Asia 2023? So when it is about the top ranking institutions, majority of the times either it is IISc, Indian Institute of Science in Bangalore, or it is IIT Bombay. So here again, IIT Bombay is the one which is at the top. So QS World University Ranking for 2023 has been released for Asian universities. The top one is Beijing based Peking University, then we have National University of Singapore, and again Tsinghua University of China. India, we have 19 universities which have featured on this list, and the top ones are IIT Bombay, IIT Delhi, IISc and IIT Madras, and these are their respective rankings. So you have to remember the top one and its rank as well. Which company has received the license from Reserve Bank of India to set up a non-banking financial company? So it is FP Cash. Okay, now the basic idea of this NBFC is to disburse loan worth 100 crores in the financial year 2022 to 23. So that's the basic idea of this FP Cash. Recently, Union Minister for Finance and Corporate Affairs approved the final sovereign green bonds framework of India. Which of the foreign statements is correct in relation to the framework? So here we have the first statement: it will strengthen India's commitment towards its nationally determined contribution target. All the decisions related to the issuance of green bonds will be taken by the Green Finance Working Committee. RBI Governor Shaktikant Das is the chairperson of this committee. So here the right answer is option D, because Shaktikant Das is not the chairperson of this Green Bond Committee. Okay, I am going to tell you the chairperson. The chairperson is basically the economic advisor of India, Anand Nageshwar. Okay, so let's discuss the framework itself. First of all, pay attention to the word sovereign green bond. Sovereign is something that is issued or is under the responsibility of the government. Green is for the environment. So clearly, these bonds will be issued for raising money to put into the projects that will help in the mitigation of climate risk and help in greening the environment. Okay, greening India. So these bonds will be issued by the government. So through these bonds, money will be raised and that money will be used for the projects. That's the basic idea. Okay, now guys, it will strengthen India's commitment under the nationally determined contributions, because the basic idea is to reduce emissions, and if we are investing in the green projects, then definitely it is going to help us in that way. The next is, Ministry of Finance has also formed a green working committee under the chairmanship of the economic advisor V. Anant Nageshwaran for the issuance of the green bonds. So this committee is going to take care of everything related to the issuance of the green bond, and the initiative will help India in achieving its Panchamrit. The Panchamrit is the target Prime Minister has announced during the COP26. So these are the five targets. Okay. So the next question is, which article of the Constitution details about the establishment of Supreme Court? So here guys, Article 124 is the right answer. But why are we discussing about the Supreme Court directly? So here guys, 15th Chief Justice of India, that is D.Y. Chandrachud, was appointed. He has assumed office and he is the only person who has stepped into his father's shoes literally. So because his father Y.V. Chandrachud has served as a Chief Justice of India, and now he is also serving as the Chief Justice of India, and he is the 15th Chief Justice of India. Okay, so number is important, 15th. Now let's discuss about Supreme Court as well. So Article 124 of the Constitution establishes the Supreme Court. Okay, Supreme Court came into existence on the Republic Day of India, 26 January 1950. Prior to Supreme Court, we had a Federal Court. Okay, so the name of the court was Federal Court, and it was established in 1937. From 1937 till 1950, we had the Federal Court operating or handling the cases. Now, with the Constitution getting implemented on 26 January 1950, the Supreme Court came into its existence as the apex court of India. Okay. Now, the President, on the recommendation of the National Judicial Appointment Commission, that is the Collegium, appoints the judges, the Chief Justice and the other judges of the Supreme Court. The tenure of the judges is not fixed in the Supreme Court. It is either the age of 65 years, okay, they serve the office, and majority of the times they retire because they achieve the age of 65 years of age. Justice Harilal Jacky Sundas Kania was the first Chief Justice of India from 1950 to 51. Which country has appointed Olympic gold medalist Neeraj Chopra as its friendship ambassador? So here Switzerland is the right answer. It has appointed Neeraj Chopra as friendship ambassador to, you can say, strengthen the relationship between India and Switzerland. So guys, here is the Switzerland. You can clearly see it shares its land boundaries with France, Germany, Austria and Italy. Okay. And on the border of Austria and Switzerland, we have a very small country called Liechtenstein. Okay. So that's a country which is entirely based on the borders of Austria and Switzerland. There is one country which is based on the border of France and Spain, and it became a member of IMF as well last year, but it became a member of IMF. Now you have to tell me that which is this country which I have marked. National Legal Services Day is observed on November 9 to commemorate the establishment of the National Legal Services Authority on this day in 1999. Okay, so 1995, sorry, that was a mistake. 1995 mein NALSA was established, and the Chief Justice of India is the patron in chief of NALSA. What's the purpose of this organization? It provides the legal services and aid to the poor and needy who cannot afford. So it arranges the lawyers and everything for them, and also works for the for increasing the legal awareness among the people. Okay. Which state has won the India Agribusiness Best State Award 2022? So Haryana guys has won this award. So National Fisheries Development Board, which is in Hyderabad, has won the India Agribusiness Award under the fisheries sector, and Haryana has won this award in the Best State category. The awards were presented during the India International Agro Trade and Technology Fair at the Indian Agriculture Research Institute in New Delhi. And that is the basic information. Haryana has won this best state, and this institute has won in the best institute in the fisheries sector. Recently, India has been named as a host country for the 2023 IBF World Boxing Championship. Now, where is the headquarters of International Boxing Association? Okay, IBF. So yeah, the headquarters are in Lausanne in Switzerland. Okay. So that is the basic idea. India is going to host the 2023 Women's World Boxing Championship. The next question is, how many Eat Right stations are present in India as of November 2022? So obviously the time period is mentioned in the question. There must be something about the Eat Right stations. So a new station has been added. So now the stations are 6. A total of 6 railway stations in India have been given this certification of Eat Right station by FSSAI, which launched this Eat Right scheme. So, Eat Right 4-star Eat Right station certification has been given to the Bhopal railway station, which has become the 6th railway station to get this certification. Now, other railway stations are Anand Vihar Terminal, Chhatrapati Shivaji Terminus, Mumbai Central, Vadodara, Chandigarh. Now, guys, there are only 6 such stations. Therefore, it is your responsibility that you know the number as well as the name of the stations, because they are only 6. Until this number becomes 60 or so huge that you are unable to remember, you need to remember the number as well as the names. Okay, if they are increased to 10, then also it is feasible for you to remember the number of stations which have been given this certification, because sometimes such questions are asked in the examination. Okay, where will India's first multimodal logistics park be done? So it will be developed at Chennai. Okay, Mapedu, Chennai, may this first multimodal logistic park will be developed. Multimodal means various modes of transportation can be inhabited into this logistic park. Road transportation ke liye trucks, trains and sea level transportation ke liye ships ki harbor bhi develop ki jayegi is logistics park. So guys, it is India's first multimodal logistics park that is going to be developed in Chennai. There is one multimodal logistics park which is termed as India's first. So which one is this? It is India's first international multimodal logistics park, which is being developed at Jogegopa in Assam. So guys, it is a very important fact. Please remember that two multimodal parks are being developed. One is in Assam, which is India's first international multimodal logistic park, because it will be developed in Jogegopa and in Assam. And another one is this Chennai one, the multimodal logistics parks of India, which is developed by the Reliance industry. So that is another fact which makes it very important. Next question is, which country has announced to launch world's longest luxury sleeper cruise? So you will be proud to know this, that it is India which will launch this world's longest luxury cruise river service in January 2023. So it is going to go operational in just 2 months. Now it is the longest luxury river cruise because it is going to connect Varanasi with Dibrugarh in Assam. Okay, so it is going to travel such a long way through Bangladesh. So in between, Bangladesh is going to be covered. Okay, 4000 kilometers ka distance hoga, which will be covered by this Ganga Vilas cruise. Okay, remember the name Ganga Vilas, Ganga Nadi pe hai. So for implementing this initiative or operationalizing this river cruise, an MOU has been signed by the Inland Waterways Authority of India with the Antara Luxury River Cruises and GM Bakshi River Cruises. Okay, so these are the two companies with which Inland Waterways Authority of India has signed an MOU. India hosted the second BIMSTEC Agriculture Minister Level meeting under the chairmanship of Narendra Singh Tomar. When was BIMSTEC formed? Okay, so that's the question. When was it formed? So here, guys, the BIMSTEC was formed in 1992. What has happened recently? Second BIMSTEC agricultural meeting has happened and it was chaired by Narendra Singh Tomar of India. The members of the partner countries, the agricultural ministers of the member countries, have participated in this BIMSTEC meeting. Okay, so let's know the partner countries. Okay, so if you divide it, your Myanmar and Thailand would come. So Sri Lanka is the first, then we have India ke saath we have Nepal and Bhutan, and then we have Bangladesh, then we have Myanmar, and then we have Thailand. I should have put a picture of the map here, but let's see if there is a map or not. Okay, so there is no map here. Try to remember the map which I have drawn if it does not look very much fine to you. Okay, so guys, theek hai? So in this manner you can try to remember. Sri Lanka is in Bay of Bengal, India touches Bay of Bengal, Myanmar, Thailand touches Bay of Bengal, Bangladesh touches Bay of Bengal, and Nepal, Bhutan is like our children. We have brought it into this BIMSTEC organization. Okay, because Nepal, Bhutan does not have any boundary with the Bay of Bengal, but still it is a member of this BIMSTEC because it's like our children. Okay, we can understand it in that manner. Isse yaad karna aasan ho jayega. Now BIMSTEC ki summit hui thi isi saal, which was held in Colombo, Sri Lanka, and it was very remarkable because Sri Lanka was itself struggling through the economic crisis, and during that time, which is still going on, BIMSTEC summit was conducted, and during that summit the financial assistance was given to Sri Lanka for setting up the technology center of BIMSTEC in Colombo. So that is another important point that you all should remember. Now coming back to BIMSTEC, let's know certain facts about it. BIMSTEC stands for Bay of Bengal Initiative for Multi-Sectoral Technical and Economic Cooperation. Okay, so divide the name of BIMSTEC into three parts: Bay of Bengal Multi-Sectoral Technical and Economic Cooperation. Forget about the prepositions, they will come into picture when you write it down. Okay, So Bay of Bengal multi-sectoral technical and economic cooperation. So it is the Bay of Bengal initiative for multi-sectoral technical and economic cooperation. It is a regional organization. Obviously it is in the Southeast and South Asian region. It was established on 6 June 1997. So remember, on 6 June we have BIMSTEC Day. Okay, Bangkok Declaration was signed to establish BIMSTEC, and this can become a question that which organization was established by the Bangkok Declaration. If that is your question, you should be aware of the fact that BIMSTEC was established with the Bangkok Declaration. Okay, initially it was BISTEC, not BIMSTEC, because we had Bangladesh, India, Sri Lanka and Thailand into this membership, into this organization, but later on Myanmar, Bhutan and your Nepal was also added into this organization. But still, in RBI, SEBI and NABARD, they don't ask such deep-rooted facts. So you can skip memorizing these facts, that when was Myanmar, Nepal or Bhutan added into the BIMSTEC. Sorry, and who were the initial members of BIMSTEC? You can just remember that the current members are 7, and which are those members? Sri Lanka, India. Sabse niche se start karoge, toh it will be easier for you to remember. Sri Lanka, then we have India, here Nepal, Bhutan, here Bangladesh, here Myanmar and Thailand. So in this manner you can remember the nations. BIMSTEC is a sectoral collaboration. You will understand why do we say sectoral collaboration once I show you the picture. But let me first tell you the headquarters. The headquarters are in Dhaka, Bangladesh. But that's a country which has majority of its, you can say, landscape in the Bay of Bengal only. Okay, the peninsula entirely lies in the Bay of Bengal. So through that, you can easily remember that Dhaka is the headquarters of BIMSTEC. Secretary General is from Bhutan at present, Tenzin Lakpal. Okay, now let's discuss this fact that BIMSTEC is a sectoral collaboration. So here we have countries which are given the responsibilities of different sectors. For example, India is handling the security part, and the subsectors are counter-terrorism, transnational crime, disaster management and energy. What do we mean by sectors? So India is going to contribute in the field of security in BIMSTEC. So if any member is struggling through any of these things, India is going to put a helping hand, and on the platform of BIMSTEC only, India is going to provide the solutions and the new innovations which have taken place in the field of security, so that other members can also benefit from it. Similarly, if we take Sri Lanka into account, science, technology and innovation, if new technology has come into place and it already has knowledge of it, so it is going to provide that knowledge among the BIMSTEC members as well. It will leverage that technology for the use of other members also. So that's the basic idea. Okay, now no need to remember the subsectors and the sectors of each and every country, just focus on India. Question number 45. Which of the following portal has been launched by President Draupadi Murmu in Odisha in November 2022? So here eKumbh is the right answer. Okay. So this eKumbh does not have anything to do with the Kumbh Mela. It is basically the portal that will help in translating the engineering books and courses into the regional languages. So there are 12 regional languages which are targeted through the eKumbh, okay, and all these languages are the scheduled languages, okay, they are mentioned in the scheduled along with the other languages. So there are total 22 scheduled languages. You have to tell me that in which schedule of the Indian Constitution are these languages mentioned, okay. Now coming back to this portal, so it is the portal of the Ministry of Education which will translate the engineering courses and books into regional languages. Statue of Prosperity is the statue of which popular leader? So here, Nara Prabhu Kempegowda is the right answer. Now let me start it from the very scratch. Prime Minister visited Bangalore and there he launched multiple projects. So we are going to look at every project one by one. First project is the Vande Bharat Express, and it is the first express in the South India. Okay, North India mein to we have Vande Bharat Express. Now in South India also Vande Bharat Express has been launched, which is also called Train 18. Okay, so the points are Mysore and Mysore and Chennai will be connected through Bangalore. Okay, that's the first. Second is Bharat Gaurav Kashi Darshan is again a train that has been flagged off at the KSR railway station in Bangalore. So that is also another project and important at the same time. Now Nara Prabhu Kempegowda, his statue has been unveiled. So this is the statue and it has been unveiled at the airport. Kempegowda Airport, International Airport, which is also known as Bangalore International Airport. Okay. So this is the leader. He is credited with the establishment of the city of Bangalore, and that is why his statue has been developed here. And also remember that his statue is called the Statue of Prosperity. Now let me first show you the prominent statues of India. Okay. So first we have the Statue of Unity in Kevadia, Gujarat, which is of Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel, which is the tallest statue of the world because its height is 597 feet. And if you take it in meters, it's 182 meters. Statue of Equality we have in Telangana, okay? Venkan Guda, Telangana, which is of Ramanuja Charya Swami. Okay, so he was a very prominent saint of the 11th and 12th century. So his statue is established in Telangana. Then we have the Statue of Prosperity of Nada Prabhu Kempe Goda, who is a very important chieftain or the leader, you can say. So it is established at the Kempe Goda International Airport in Bangalore. Then, remember, it is the world's tallest bronze statue. This statue at Kevadia is of steel. The Nada Prabhu statue is of bronze. And if we take all the bronze statues into account, then this is the tallest bronze statue. Okay, I know it's a little bit tricky, but what can we do when our government is very much, you can say, maniac about the tallest and the superlatives. Okay, coming to the last statue, which is being built, the Statue of Oneness. So it is being developed at Omkareshwar, Madhya Pradesh, and it will be of Adi Shankaracharya, the very prominent Shaivite, you can say, saint. So his statue is being developed at Omkareshwar, which is a very, very religious place of Lord Shiva. So there, his statue is being developed. So these are the four statues: Statue of Unity, Equality, Prosperity, and Oneness. So you should be aware of all these statues. Kiske hain, kaha par hain, aur kitne unche hain. Theek hai? Kyunki ye koi na koi accolade ko hold kar rahe hain. Now, थोड़ा सा कैंपे गोड़ा के बारे में पढ़ते हैं. He was a 16th century chieftain under the Vijayanagar Empire. So he is not of contemporary times. He is of Vijayanagar Empire. Okay. And he is credited with establishing the Bangalore city in 1537. Okay. So that's a very important fact. Now, this fact, this name is very important. You can expect a question of this. Ram Varji Sutta. He is the one who has designed the Statue of Unity and Statue of Prosperity. Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel statue and Nada Prabhu Kempe Goda's statue. Both of them have been designed by the same person, Ram Varji Sutta. So remember this name. It is very, very important. Okay. He has also developed the statue of Mahatma Gandhi at Bangalore's Vidhan Sabha. Okay. Vidhan Sabha. So that is all. Now one more thing, that World Book of Records has featured this Nada Prabhu Kempe Goda's statue as the world's tallest bronze statue. So that is very important. Okay. First and tallest bronze statue. So question number 47 is, who heads the expert committee on Swamitva scheme? So here B.K. Agarwal is the right answer. Now this committee was formed in 2022, and the basic idea is to give the recommendations to improve the Swamitva scheme. So I hope, guys, you have covered this Swamitva scheme thoroughly. This scheme was launched to assess the property, the land ownership, by using the modern day technologies. Now under this scheme only, this committee was created so that the recommendations can be provided. Now here the first recommendation is that the scheme needs to create a system for promoting transparency in the implementation. Second is to adopt the proper records of rights for availing the bank loan, so that the people can mortgage their lands against the bank loan. And if we have the proper property records, only then we can use those records as the property to mortgage against. Third is, develop the linkages between different departments for informed decision making related to the property tax assessment and collection. Then adopt this system, that is rural area development plan formulation and implementation. Next is wider adoption of Swamitva data sets by government and private agencies as per the new geospatial guidelines. So that should be done. The next question is, how much amount has been contributed by India in Asian India Science Tech Fund? So this amount is $5 million. So this was given during the Asian Summit. So 9th Asian India Summit and 17th East Asia Summit. Both of these summits were organized in Phnom Penh, which is the capital of Cambodia. Okay. So it was attended by the Vice President of India, that is Jagdeep Dhankar. Now here, First of all, remember that East Asia Summit is basically, East Asia is not a separate forum like we have Asia as a regional organization. East Asia Summit is not an organization, it is just a summit, and the entire work related to this summit is the responsibility of ASEAN organization only. Okay, so this summit is always held alongside the ASEAN summit. Okay, so whenever there is an ASEAN summit or ASEAN India summit, this East Asia summit is also organized in the same city where the ASEAN is organizing its main summit. Now, in East Asia, which members are there? ASEAN's 10 members and other 8 countries: India, China, Japan, Korea, Australia, New Zealand, and USA and Russia. Now, here during the summit, certain developments have taken place. Let's look at them. Okay, so first is that 4 agreements have been signed between India and Cambodia in different fields, like in the wildlife field, in culture, and in health. One MOU has been signed between IIT Jodhpur and Institute of Technology of Cambodia so that they can increase their cooperation in digital documentation of cultural heritage. Okay, and one more initiative was taken or agreement was signed, that is for the biodiversity conservation and sustainable wildlife management. And under this agreement, the tigers will be reintroduced in Cambodia. Like we reintroduced cheetahs from Namibia, Cambodia is going to reintroduce tigers from India. Probably from India, these tigers will be transported to Cambodia. Then, very important thing has happened, that is a new member has been added into ASEAN, that is East Timor. Okay, so this is the group's 11th member. So now ASEAN is no more a 10 member organization, it has its 11th member as East Timor. India has contributed $5 million to the ASEAN India Science Tech Fund, and Dhankar has inaugurated a hall of dance at the Thaphrom Temple in Siam Reap, Cambodia. Now pay attention to this fact that Siam Reap is a very important archaeological and cultural site in Cambodia. And this temple is very important. Okay, Thaphrom Temple. Even you would be surprised to know that Ramayana is the epic, national epic of Cambodia and many Southeast Asian countries. And there are Vishnu temples in such countries. In Cambodia also, there is the Vishnu temple. We have Shivling also in Cambodia. Okay. So it is the cultural spread that happened from Chola dynasty onward in the Southeast Asia nations. Next is ASEAN India Startup Festival. So it is the first time that a startup festival was organized, and during the festival, a pitch battle named competition was also organized. Then 2022 is an important year because it marks the 17th anniversary of India-Cambodia relationship and 30th anniversary of India-ASEAN relationship. Okay, therefore 2022 was the India-ASEAN friendship year. Next question is, which state has launched the Mukhyamantri Shiksha Protsahan scheme? So here guys, Jharkhand is the right. Jharkhand has launched many schemes. First is Shiksha Protsahan scheme, under which the class 10th students who have passed class 10th, they will receive free coaching for engineering, NEET and other competitive examinations. Okay, so that they can clear them after their 12th. Then we have Eklavya Prashikshan scheme, under which the training will be provided for the competitive examinations like UPSC, Bank PO, Jharkhand PCS, etc. Then we have Guruji Student Card Yojana, which is a very old scheme. Okay, it has not been launched now. It provides financial support to the poor children so that they can continue with their higher studies. Then we have Mukhyamantri Sarathi Yojana, which provides skill training to the youth so that they can become employable. And the last fact is that November 15 is the foundation day of Jharkhand, and on that day only all these schemes were launched. Which state is implementing the Lakshmi Bhandar scheme? So it is West Bengal, and recently this scheme has received Scotch Award, okay, in the Women and Child Development category. So this scheme was launched in 2022, and the basic purpose is to ensure the basic income support to the women heads of the households in the state of West Bengal. Under the policy, ₹500 is given to general category families and ₹1,000 is given to the SCST families. And what are these Scotch Awards? You must have heard about them many a times, because they are given to different initiatives of the government as well as the state government and the organizations of the government. So these awards are instituted in 2003, and they aim to recognize people, projects and institutions that go extra mile to make India a better place. Okay, so that's the relevance of the Scotch Awards. Which ministry administers the works related to Aadhaar card. So here, majority of you would be thinking Ministry of Home Affairs. But guys, the right answer is Ministry of Electronics and Information Technology and not the Home Affairs. Okay? We tend to think that it is related to the people's data, the citizens' data, as Census Commissioner and Registrar General of India is also under the Ministry of Home Affairs. Aadhaar must be under the Ministry of Home Affairs only. But here, there is a twist. It is under the Ministry of Electronics and IT because Aadhaar and the UIDAI both are administered by the ministry. Okay, UIDAI administers Aadhaar and it has been constituted under the Ministry of Electronics and IT through the Aadhaar Act of 2016. Therefore, it is a statutory body. And if there is any change that needs to be made in this organization, then this act has to be amended. That is the meaning and benefit of being a statutory body. Okay, so that much is enough. Okay, I forgot to tell you the recent update. So the recent update is that you have to update your Aadhaar details, biometrics and everything every 10 years. Okay, so this is an information for all of you guys. If your Aadhaar has completed 10 years, then it's time for you to update your details. Okay, so book an appointment, go to the nearest common service center and update all the details. You can also do it through the Aadhaar or UIDAI application, website on the browser. Okay, question number 52 is, which multilateral agency has partnered with India for organizing the City's Credit Worthiness Academy workshop? So here, World Bank is the right answer. Department of Economic Affairs, Ministry of Finance, Ministry of Housing and Urban Affairs and World Bank. These three organizations, because the Department of Economic Affairs is under the Ministry of Finance only. So these three organizations have organized this workshop, City's Credit Worthiness Academy. And the basic idea of this workshop is to create an enabling ecosystem for financing future cities of India. There was a theme as well, vision of future cities and role of municipal financing. Okay, so these are the important facts, at least the theme and the organizations organizing this workshop. The next question is, which is the focus state in the 41st edition of India International Trade Fair? So here, Uttar Pradesh and Kerala are the focus states. This trade fair is organized at Pragati Maidan in New Delhi. Pragati Maidan is being redeveloped, okay, as the, you can say, international exhibition center. Okay, so that is the fact related to Pragati Maidan. Now coming back to this news, 41st edition of the India International Trade Fair was inaugurated by Piyush Goyal, who is the Minister of Commerce, Industry, Food and Distribution and Textile also. Now this year Bihar, Jharkhand, Maharashtra are the partner states in organizing the event, and Uttar Pradesh and Kerala are the focus state. So you can clearly see one state is the one who is excelling in all the social indicators, whereas the other one is the state which almost is found at the lowest side. Okay. The next question is, what is the theme of G20 summit in 2022? So recently the Bali summit was organized. I hope you must have seen the Prime Minister shaking hands with UK Prime Minister and other Prime Ministers of different countries. Then China's Xi Jinping President has also made certain controversies with the Canadian Prime Minister Justin Trudeau. So all of this is going on. I hope you have heard about it. Okay. So what is happening? G20 summit is over. The theme of the summit was recover together, recover stronger. Okay. Now three sessions were organized during the G20 summit, which were focusing on the sustainable energy transition, the global health architecture and digital transformation. One more important thing, that B20 summit, that is Business 20 summit, is a part of the G20, not exactly a part of the G20 summit, but it's, you can say it's like a branch of the G20, okay, wherein the businesses, the business owners come together and they discuss the new innovations and the way ahead. Okay, so this summit was organized in Bali, Indonesia, and during that summit only the presidency of B20 was handed over to India, as we have the G20 presidency for the next year. Okay, and I hope you also have heard about the logo and the controversy surrounding it. Okay, the lotus controversy, I hope you are aware of it. So this is the logo of G20 summit which India is going to organize, and the theme, Vasudhaivam Kutumbakam, Vadat, one family, one future. Okay, Vasudhaiv is the earth, Kutumbakam is family, Kutumb is family. Okay, so in the Bali summit we have two important initiatives: Indonesia Just Energy Partnership. It is a partnership with US, UK, Germany, France, European Union, Canada, Italy, Norway, Denmark, and it is basically going to work on the energy efficiency, okay, making the energy more green and sustainable. Global shield against climate risk initiative. So it is a social protection and insurance based finance mechanism for the loss caused by the natural disaster. So suppose there is a natural disaster in any country, so the support will be provided through this initiative to that country so that it can undertake the mitigation effort and rehabilitation efforts. The next question is, as per 2022 food outlook report, the world's food import bill will reach a record high level of dash in 2022. So it will reach near $2 trillion and $1.94 trillion to be more precise. So this is the report by Food and Agriculture Organization. Now guys, there is one thing related to such reports. Such reports have not been asked in the phase 1 general awareness of RBI, SEBI and NABARD for quite some time now. Okay, so what do we do in that scenario? Should we cover these reports or should we leave these reports? So if you ask my opinion, then in my opinion you should cover these reports but smartly. Now how? That I'm going to tell you. So food outlook report has been released by the FAO. Obviously food is there, so you don't need to remember the organization releasing it because it is FAO. Okay, the second important fact is the most important highlight. Okay, if you search this food outlook report, you will find that every news headline is telling you that the import bill is reaching near $2 trillion. So that is the most important fact, that the food import bill, the imports that the countries are making around the world for food, that is reaching $1.94 trillion in 2022. So this is the most important fact, the amount. Okay, then the global import bill for agricultural inputs, the raw material for agriculture, is reaching $424 billion in 2022. The global production of wheat is expected to reach 784 million tons in 2022 to 2023, with high concentrations in Russia and China. Not a very significant fact, just remember Russia and China are going to be the largest producers of wheat as per the food outlook report. But this quantum is not important, the quantity is not important. Okay, this is just given for your understanding that this much would be the production and these countries would be the sources of the supply. Okay, the next is global production of rice is expected to decline, whereas the production of wheat was increased. The 2022 to 23 global harvest is expected to remain at an overall average level of 512.6 million tons. Not at all very important if you don't have any examination coming here soon. Okay, otherwise if you have any examination, then this statement, the total global harvest and the total import bill, these two statements are important. So just remember the figures of these two statements. Okay, the next question is, which of the following parameters has the highest weightage in German Watt's climate change performance index 2023? So here this is the phase 2 type of a question, but nowadays we are seeing that phase 1 level is also getting increased, so we need to focus on such questions as well. Now which parameter has the highest weightage? So it is greenhouse gas emissions, 40% weightage hai iska. This effective green advocacy is not a parameter of this index. Okay, so the parameters are renewable energy 20% weightage, energy use 20% weightage, climate policy 20% weightage. So all these others are important and easy to remember. GHG emission has the highest, 40% weightage. Total 63 countries were assessed. German Watch has released this index. We have discussed about the weightages. So let's move on to the rankings. First three ranks are empty because no country was able to score the milestone or the benchmark to be in the first three categories. Then we have Denmark at the topmost rank, we can say, which starts at the fourth number. So Denmark, Sweden, Chile is at the sixth number, then Morocco, India is at the eighth number. And you can clearly see the scores of India parameter wise. Scores are also important as far as India is concerned. So let's have a look at the overall score of India, which is 67.35. Parameter wise are these, okay, which you can memorize, okay, by reading it again and again. These are the bottom countries, okay. So all the red mark countries are the bottom ones, and Iran is at the 63rd position. Which company has launched the Sukh Samriddhi insurance policy? So ICICI Prudential Life Insurance is the right answer. Nothing much is there. Sukh Samriddhi policy is by ICICI Prudential Life. That much is enough. Which bank has topped the Indian Banks Association's ease reforms index for the first quarter of FY23? So here SBI is the right answer. Now let me inform you that there is an ease index by the Ministry of Finance, And there is this reforms index by this Indian Banking Association. So this Indian Banks Association is not a government body. It is a self, it is an industry body which basically has the members from the banks, public and private banks. Okay. So this association has released this ease reform index, and obviously if you compare the ease index of Ministry of Finance and this index, then obviously the ease of Ministry of Finance is going to take more importance. Okay, so this one is very, very important, and its fifth edition was launched in June only, so cover that as well. Okay, thoroughly. Now coming to this ease reforms index, now please remember ease reforms index by IBA and ease 5.0 by Ministry of Finance, because that can also be a question. Okay, which organization releases which index? Now this index is for the first quarter of FY23, so basically from April to September it has assessed the performance of the banks, whether they are performing up to the mark as far as the financial indicators are concerned. So let's have a look at the, firstly at the parameters. First parameter was the digitally enabled customer offering, big data analytics, modern technology capabilities, collaborative banking, employee development and governance. So these were the parameters on which the banks were assessed. Okay, top bank is SBI, then UBI, then Bank of Baroda. Top three are important, just remember them, and these are not important. Okay, don't try to mark all of them. As far as the theme based rankings are concerned, so you can remember the rank one only. So in digitally enabled customers of offerings, SBI is at the top, and I don't know why SBI is at the top, because personally I believe their digital services are not that up to the mark, but still SBI is at the top. Then we have big data and analytics, which is topped by Canara Bank. Modern technology capabilities, UBI. Collaborative and development focused banking, UCO. Employee development and governance, Union Bank of India. So that was the reforms, ease reforms index. So question 59 is, who has been appointed as a CEO of Prasar Bharati? So here Gaurav Dwivedi, who is an IAS officer, is the right answer. Who is the recipient of Satyajit Ray Lifetime Achievement Award at the 53rd edition of the International Film Festival of India? So first of all, let me tell you the answer. Carlos Saura is the right answer. Now, a very static fact related to this International Film Festival of India is that it is organized in Goa every year. Okay, so Goa is the permanent place for this festival. Now, its 53rd edition is going to be organized from November 20 to 28, and France is the spotlight country. Okay, and 8 films will be screened under the country focus package from France. 8 films will be screened. Not a very significant fact, but France is the spotlight country. That is a significant fact. The second edition of the 75 Creative Minds of Tomorrow, which is an initiative of the Ministry of Broadcasting and Information, will be launched. Okay, will be a focus of this mission. Satyajit Ray Award, Lifetime Achievement Award. Carlos Saura, who is a Spanish film director. 61st question, where will the 19th conference of the parties of sides be conducted? So it will be conducted in Panama. Okay, so recently what has happened, India put forward a proposal to basically include the red crowned turtle into the category of endangered animals. Okay, so it's red crowned rooted turtle, and now this proposal has been accepted by CITES, which is Convention on International Trade in Endangered Species, because these turtles are at the very high risk of extinction. Now coming to this conference of parties to CITES, so it will be organized from November 14 to 25. Okay, so it was there from November 14 to 25 in Panama. Now where is Panama? So guys, this is Panama. I hope you are able to see it. Okay, this is Panama. This narrow strip of land, this type of strip of land is called isthmus. Okay, isthmus is the term for the very narrow strip of land that joins two large land masses. So here, this North America and the South American continents are getting joined by the Panama Isthmus. Okay, and by cutting this Panama Isthmus, we have the Panama Canal also, that was developed by US in order to cut its time. Earlier, its navies used to travel through entire South America to reach this point, the ships. Okay, so this is the isthmus of Panama, and Colombia and Costa Rica are the countries through which Panama shares its borders, and Caribbean Sea is the sea bordering Panama country. When was the Digital Shakti campaign launched by the National Commission for Women? So 2018 में launch किया गया था and the basic purpose is to create awareness among women about the cyber space so that they can be safe and they can get employment as well if they are skilled in that field. So in order to digitally empower them and skilled women to ensure their safety in the cyber space, this initiative was launched by the National Commission for Women. The next question is, in which state is India Hydrogen Alliance setting up a $575 million green hydrogen hub in southern India? So obviously this question is flawed because the answer is in the question itself. But the right answer here is Kerala. You must have known by now. So it is basically a green hydrogen hub that will be created in Kochi, Kerala. What is this IH2A Alliance? It is a coalition of firms like Reliance Industries and steel firms like JSW, US-based Chart Industries and etc. etc. So it's a coalition of different companies, and Niti Aayog is also a member of this IH2A Alliance, which works for the development projects in the field of sustainability. Okay, so sustainable development projects are developed by this alliance. Question number 64. Bangala is the festival of which state? So it is the festival of Meghalaya. The Garo tribe in Meghalaya celebrates this drum festival, and also remember it is also called the 100 drums festival. So it can also be asked in the examination that which state celebrates the 100 drums festival. So again, Meghalaya would be the right answer. Okay, 46th edition of this festival was celebrated. With which company has the Energy and Resource Institute signed an MOU to promote Urja Arpan initiative? So here guys, Tata Power Delhi Distribution Limited is the right answer. Okay, so basically, the Urja Arpan initiative aims to aware the customers about the energy usage as well as how can they reduce their power. They can also choose from multiple options to reduce their energy consumption. They can also contribute towards ensuring power reliability. So this is basically an energy sustainability option. So under the Urja Arpan, the education is given to the consumer. Basically, awareness is spread among the consumers about the significance of clean energy solution. So how will the consumer use the clean energy? They can basically install the solar panels at their rooftop so that they can not only use it at their homes but also contribute to the national grid. But for that, awareness is needed, and that awareness is spread through this Urja Arpan initiative. Which agency has released the Financing India's Infrastructure Needs Constraints to Commercial Financing Prospects for Policy Action Report? So it is released by the World Bank. So this report basically states that India needs to invest $840 billion in infrastructure over the next 15 years, or an average $55 billion per year in the infrastructure to meet the needs. Only 5% of the infrastructure needs in India at present is met by the private sector. The rest is given by the government only. Okay, the financing is given by the government only. The central and state government finance more than 75% of the city infrastructure. Urban local bodies finance 15% through their own surplus revenue. So that is what the report states. Another fact is that by 2036, as many as 600 million people will be living in cities in India, representing 40% of the total population. And at present also, India's urban population, the population living in cities, is very much high in comparison to the other countries. So if the urbanization is not planned, then it is going to lead to dysfunctional urbanization and a chaos in the future. Now on that note, my question from all of you is, can you tell me when do we celebrate the World Cities Day? This is your question. Which country has recently announced the end of its decade-long cooperation bargain in Africa? So here the right answer is France. So this Operation Barkhane was launched by France in 2013, and at that point of time the name was Operation Serval, okay, because it was launched in the Sahel region of Africa. So it was limited to the Al-Qaeda group only to cater to their terrorism, but later on they expanded the reach to tackle the terrorism in general and not to of any particular organization. Okay, and therefore they changed the name to Operation Barkhane. Okay, how many countries are signatories to the FAO's Agreement on Port State Measures as of November 2022? So here the right answer is 100. Four countries have joined the agreement, and now the number is 100. So the four countries are Angola, Eritrea, Morocco and Nigeria. Now what is this agreement? it is basically preventing the illegal fishing, illegal transportation of fishes from one port to another. Okay, so how is this agreement doing that? It is controlling the access to the ports by deploying more officials on the ports. So if you are not able to land on the port, how are you going to sell your you can say trafficked fishes? Okay, so that is the basic idea, and it came into force in 2016. Which of the following statement is incorrect about the World Population Prospects 2022 report? So guys, the right answer here is option E, none of the above. Okay, let me just go to the report itself. So it was the 27th edition of the report, and as for the report, the world reached 8 billion population. And there is a very interesting fact here. Did you know that on November 15, the 8 billionth child was born, and in the world completed 8 billion population, and that is why on November 15, 8 billionth day is celebrated. So isn't it surprising or funny rather that we are celebrating the 8 billionth day on November 15th, because on that day we reached the population mark of 8 billion. So right now the population is this, and by 2030 the population would be 8.5 billion. By 2050 the population would be 9.7 billion. And by 2080 the population would be 4 billion, and it will remain till that level by 2100. So that's the basic, projection that has been given by this World Population Prospects report. So there are only four numbers that you have to remember. 8 billion we have reached, 8.5 by 2030, then we have the mark of 9.7 billion, then we have 4 billion. So these are the four population projections. And these are the eight countries from where the majority of the population would come from, or basically would reside. So these are the major contributors to the population. You can clearly see the top 10 countries of the population. Last question of the day. So thankfully we are at the last question. Recently the Ministry of Finance has issued notification stating that all GST anti-profiteering complaints will be dealt with by the Competition Commission of India from December 1st, as the extended tenure of National Anti-Profiteering Authority ends this month. When was the National Anti-Profiteering Authority established? So it was established in 2017. So it's a very basic question, because in 2017 only GST came into force, and with that only this organization came into force. Now the purpose of this organization was to check the unfair profiteering. Okay, how is unfair profiteering takes place? Suppose the vendor has taken the benefit of input tax credit, and the vendor is not letting that benefit translate to permeate to the customer by reducing the prices of the goods. Okay, then it would be a profiteering. Okay, suppose the GST benefit has been given to the vendor and that benefit is not permeating to the consumer. So that is the unfair profiteering, unfair profit making by the vendors. And in order to curb such situations from happening, this organization was created in 2017 and it was given extensions. Now the organization has completed its tenure, and Competition Commission of India is going to take over the work. That's the basic idea. Now, the Competition Commission of India came into force through the Competition Act of 2002. So it is also a statutory body. It has a chairperson and six members. Who is the chairperson of CCI? This is your question. So here guys, thank you so much for watching this video. Have a good day. And from now onwards, the videos are going to be regular. So stay updated and stay tuned to the channel.